Hey everyone, I'm Sanket Singh. I'm working as a software engineer at Google. And welcome back to my channel. Today we have a very, very special guest on our channel. So he's like kind of someone who I have really admired. Kind of like God in the space of this tech content creation, system design, data structures and algorithms. And he has been on YouTube for quite some time. When I was in college, I used to watch his lecture to understand a lot of concepts. Now I am teaching to a lot of people, so you can assume that there is some contribution from this guy. So today we'll be talking about a very, very interesting concept in our video, that is about system design. Why do you need system design? What is system design? And from where you can learn about system design. Without any further delay, let's just start. But before starting the video, a very, very small request. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button. Don't forget to hit the like button if you find the video to be useful. And we have already touched 10K. So again, a really, 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 really big thank you to all of you guys who supported me throughout this journey. Without your support, this was definitely not possible. So a really, really thank you from my side. And if you find this video useful, then share it with your friends so that we can reach to the next milestone very, very soon. So without any further delay, let's just start and invite Gaurav on the channel. Gaurav, like, how's everything? How are you? And how's the work with interview already going on?
Interview Ready is doing well. It's been a few months since we actually had this becoming a team. Earlier it was me. So in March, Aaron joined us. Aaron Pacheco is the multi-hat product manager that we have. And apart from that, in terms of sales, which is the raw numbers, yeah, we are doing pretty well now. So I think there's a few things that we have done which have changed the way that Interview Ready is being, you know, used. One is that we went onto our own website. So we are hosting on AWS now instead of using a solution provider, which is Thinkific. The second thing is we got a team of video editors with us, so we are able to churn out videos much faster. Hopefully by the time that this video is out, we'll actually have a new chapter out also on ETL, Elastic Extract Transform Load, which is on machine learning. So yeah, it should be fun. Let's see what the reaction is like.
So like the growth is having an exponential curve, I believe. And like,
yes.
So like all those people who don't know about Gaurav, like Gaurav has been in this tech space when we all were students. Like he's not ancient, but I believe he has got a bunch of experience around multiple things. I myself remember that when I was student, when I was in college, there were a lot of instances when I used to refer videos from Gaurav to learn a lot of things. We were also discussing that I learned persistent tries and concepts like this from videos from Gaurav. So again, huge shout out to him for his contribution to the community. And
Thank you. And
the main thing that nowadays Gaurav is being exploring, because he is an experienced engineer, he worked with DirectAI, he worked with Uber. So system design is something that I'm definitely able to see Gaurav exploring nowadays. So let's just take an opinion from Gaurav that what do you think Gaurav system design is? What are the basic pillars? There are a lot of questions in the mind of students around system design, like what is system design? What is the difference between HLD and LD? And what are these terms even about? Can you like give a brief explanation around that?
Right, so if you're just starting with your career in software engineering, this is how I would like to define system design. Any system that you're building requires some sort of planning and some sort of, planning for a bad day, fault tolerance. A lot of engineering is not just meeting requirements, not just saying that this is how the button will work or this is how the request will flow from here to here. A lot of it is actually to do with what if there is a failure. Power loss is one type of failure. Okay, if your computer crashes, then users are not able to get to the system. If Facebook is depending on their power to be always on, even the generators and stuff, it's not going to work. The generator itself could collapse. Okay, so we are thinking about really negative scenarios, which is the job of an engineer, because once you think that way, your system never collapses. That's the general idea. Okay, that is fault tolerance. That is something that you bring into the design. You don't do it later on after writing the code that, oh, I need to fix this now. Right? So as an engineer, your job is to make sure that things don't fail and that basically that your things work in the real world. That is system design. What does it need? What do you need to do to be able to do this? You need to have your concepts, basic concepts on computer science fundamentals clear. One is networks, one would be databases, one would be one programming language which is strong, right? So that you understand how to code things and how it will be there in the real world. And apart from that, yeah, you have various other things also which are, I think, an extension of networks and databases. Like sometimes you might need data structure knowledge, okay? You don't need it every day for system design, but it's useful to have. Algorithms, and then if you're getting deep into system design, you might say that you need to know about the network protocols. I think I'm missing something here. What am I missing? Sanket, can you identify something that I'm missing? Databases, networks.
Operating system.
Operating system, yeah, that's a good one. Yeah. I forgot the operating system, yeah. Yeah, if you have these fundamentals clear, you should be sorted, at least as a fresher, yes.
And like, what do you think is the basic difference in these two terminologies, the high level design named as HLD and the low level design called as LLD? What do you think is the basic difference around both of these two pillars?
Right, let me take an example. For example, if I tell you to design an elevator system, okay, I'm not talking about a huge 1000 buildings, 1000 elevators. I need to scale, I need to just understand how the system will interact with each other. So when it comes to low level design, okay, in this elevator system, you are looking at low level design. Why? Because like in a compiler, there is a high level and a low level. Low level means you are very close to the system, how it is actually working in the metal. So when you talk about high level design, it is like, how is it going to work with just block diagrams and interaction? Low level, you are thinking about the code. Okay, so when you talk about design, for design, the low level will be coding. Okay, and for high level will be just drawing the blocks of the system and figuring out how they'll be interacting with each other. If you know about class diagrams, that is one type of high level design. Okay, but if you then start coding and if you start defining every class that you will need, pretty much, that will be a low level design. This is, of course, I'm trying to simplify it as much as possible. If you think about high level design for Uber or high level design for Google, that's going to be like, it depends on what level of detail you want to see. If you see, you want to see high level design of Google and you even note down every service, it is extremely complicated and complex. So in general, you want to see how is a system working, interacting. Like in a car also, you want to see the model of a car. You first see, okay, there's an engine, there's maybe a driver, there's a bunch of processes which are running and they're talking to each other. At low level, you will then go one level deeper and see that, okay, how is the carburetor affecting the fuel pipe and so on. Okay, so it's like a stack, and the lowest stack, if you say the lowest level of design will be coding, and the highest level of design will be block diagrams.
So like in LLD, we are like very much close to the exact implementation, how we are going to like code it, how we are going to like exactly write the implementation, the logic, how we are going to make that logic a bit more efficient, that I am able to understand that is more of the LLD part. And like designing how the interaction is going to be done, calculating where what are the major chunk of pieces where fault can happen, where we have to do optimization, where we have to add for the functionalities, and represent it as an architectural diagram, I guess, will be more around high level design. Makes more sense.
Okay. Yeah, what happens is as you keep getting lower and lower to the system, you start seeing things which you cannot see at a very high level. For example, I'm speaking to Sanket right now on Google Meets. So that's easy to understand. Like, okay, what did I do? I just opened this application and it's working. Now let's go one level deeper. How is it working? Oh, I'm using WebRTC. WebRTC, okay, that's interesting. Maybe that's a high level thing. Now when it comes to low level, what if Sanket disconnects from the call? Can he connect back to the call? Where are you going to send him? Which data structure? So then at code, you can see a lot deeper. However, if I ask Sanket to design the low-level design of Google Meet and tell him that you need to do it in 45 minutes, probably impractical. He'll come up with one component of that. Just the thing which does the chat, that is something I can expect in 45 minutes. I cannot expect Sanket to build Google Meet in 45 minutes. Otherwise, I'm leaving everything and I'm joining him because we are billionaires immediately. So that's what it is like. The more deeper you go, the more detailed you go, the less you can focus on. That is low-level design. Just build a cache. Just build a chatbot. While at a high level, you can actually define a lot of things and you can have a much wider understanding of the system. However, you cannot go deep. That would be high level design.
System design is something that, again, as I said, a lot of people are facing it a bit difficult, feeling it a bit difficult to understand. So like if someone is like a fresh grad, just graduated from college or maybe going to graduate from college. So let's just take an example of 2020 grads or 2021 grads or those who are going to get graduated in 2022. Like being an engineer, being a fresh grad engineer, like whatever branch you were having, but you still have some interest in the IT field, in the engineering, software engineering field. What do you think is the relevance of having a knowledge of system design? If let's say there is an engineer who knows a bit about system design, how that is going to help them and why it is even relevant for a fresh grad?
Yeah, this is an interesting question. It's the reason why I started with this system design on the YouTube channel. So I saw that a lot of fresh grads used to come fresh out of college, and they would join the company. They would be good at algorithms and data structures. They would also have some basics on networks, operating systems, and CS fundamentals, but they wouldn't know how to do software engineering. So what the interesting thing is, what you're being tested on in a job, okay, algorithms and data structures is very different from what is being taught in college, because they need a more generalized understanding. And then what you're being expected to do in engineering is totally different. software engineering. So I saw that there are people who are joining the company and then saying, what is a load balancer? What is a message queue? Okay, why are we using it? Why don't we do something simpler? Just put it in a while loop, while through, take requests. Totally sensible, right? All of these thinking is sensible because you have used it in computer programming or you have used it in a contest or in an interview. But in the real world, you don't want such complexities to be there. So you want to abstract out components. When you look at that, that is design. And as a fresher, why should you know about it? Well, as a fresher, you will be joining team meetings. You will want to build a reputation for yourself. And apart from building a reputation for yourself, like even working more efficiently, the way you're going to do that is by understanding these terms so that when the discussions are there, you're able to add value. I remember that when I used to go for team meetings initially, first 4 months, I didn't understand what they're talking about. Pretty much it used to be like, okay, a request is coming and all that. And for me, I was trying to understand, what is a request? Where is it going? How is it? What's going on here? They're talking about protocols and all that. I don't even know the differences between these protocols. Like they're talking about, we can use WebRTC and all that. Or there was another one, SIP, which was for calling. Yeah. So the problem was not just that I didn't know about SIP or WebRTC. The problem was I didn't even know the internals of the system. So then me adding value was very hard. I would just stay quiet and this became a bit of a problem. Later on, when the interns joined, I was able to quickly clear these doubts for them. And they were very happy. They said that it was instrumental in understanding like how they can, in 2 months, build for the system.
Okay, makes sense. So yeah, like I also totally agree. Like I previously worked with LinkedIn. So initially also, it was a similar scenario because working with system that was on such large scale where a hell lot of people are contributing and they know the system well. They know these fundamental concepts of design and the fundamental concepts of computers very well. You sometimes feel like, okay, this is kind of like an alien world. What we were studying, man, what we were doing when this was supposed to be taught. So yeah, this is like a similar feeling. I can definitely agree on that. So like I am able to get the point that having a knowledge around system design will help you to exactly do the things that are expected in a company or let's say your startup, wherever you are working. Because I get a notion nowadays that for getting a knowledge of what exactly is going to be done in the companies, people try to do a bit of web development and Android development. But what I have seen and experienced is companies, they have their own world, they have their own software, they have their own libraries. Everything is kind of specific company to company. And then having fundamental knowledge is better rather than knowing a particular tech stack like MERN, MEAN or something. Whereas having a knowledge of system design, having a knowledge of core database management system, having a knowledge of core networks, like exactly how an HTTP call is made, how a TCP connection is first made, then an HTTP call is made. Having these knowledge help you to learn the new things that are specific to that company or that are relatively new to you is much more easier and you are able to contribute to the overall discussions, design and the overall growth of the product. That is something definitely I would
totally agree. Yeah. No, and one very interesting thing about this, Sanket, is that if you look at algorithms and data structures, that's why people were being tested on that. There was a time, I think about 20 years ago or maybe even 15 years ago, people were saying, I know this programming language and that programming language and this and that. So what people started testing their candidates on was data structures and algorithms because they wanted it to be language independent, language agnostic. You know any language, that's okay. I know you'll learn quickly. Just like that, what's happened is because all of these systems have become large-scale distributed systems, they now want a general idea of what's going on. So system design for them is a general way in which they can understand whether this person can learn my technology stack or my infrastructure.
Yeah, like even if you like know a particular language, let's say someone say that they are proficient in Java, then also I definitely agree that in your initial days of software development, you will end up Googling a lot of things at least about Java. So having a knowledge of programming.
You think you know a lot about Java, yeah.
No, like I personally feel a bit connected to C++ and JavaScript. But yeah, like a lot of people are like kind of have a thinking that, okay, I have learned C++, what is the next language that I should learn? And that is something that they should definitely not do, right? Having core conceptual knowledge is something that is having much more value in the industry. Yeah.
Totally agree. No, so just expanding on this point, like when I joined the industry, I was like, I'm very good at Java. And I was very good for a computer programmer, but not for an industry guy because they are expecting you to code futures. They're expecting you to be able to multi-thread your code, which is never tested, right? So I realized that, oh, these classes existed. Yeah, concurrent hash map, interesting. They must be using it for some reason. So if you want to, let's say, go deep into a language, which is also one thing that you can try to use concurrent data structures and try to use asynchronous data structures like futures and stuff, promises in JavaScript. So then you see that there is a different part of the world which probably we haven't touched yet. That was my experience, yeah.
Yeah, makes sense. Like, apart from stack and heap, there is a bunch of memory that you don't know about that is going to be used even more than stack and heap. Please explore that.
When I went to Uber, and the software engineering team is very mature over there, in a sense that they take open source solutions when they can. And if they cannot, then they build those solutions by themselves, but they have very good practices to build those solutions. This is the first time you are getting interviewed by a billionaire, and I thought that he's going to ask me, you know, HR questions, where do you see yourself in 5 years?